You're asked to draw an object from observation. Where do you begin? Will you draw what you see instead of relying on other information? Drawing from observation, it turns out, is a curious mix of observation and formula. It is a mixture of observation and memory, the memory of applied drawing formulas. What makes up our observations? One answer is expectations. In other words, where we perceive, we expect. That is, we see what we learn to expect to see. Where do expectations originate? They often come from prior experience and speculative guesses. Some believe prior experience is built right into us a priori to lived experience. In drawing, prior experiences, visual and non-visual, can come from a variety of sources. Images of all types from print, web, and cinema, among which include books on drawing, classes in drawing or painting, of course, the everyday visual and tactile navigation through our three-dimensional world gives us all a set of visual expectations. It is these expectations which find their way into our drawings from observation. Beginners, for example, when drawing from life, often reach for shorthand symbols of what they think they see, instead of the shapes which actually meet their retina. A circle, for example, is in essence a circle, when thought of in general terms or when seen straight on. But what happens when that same circle is seen from a different angle? The circle then becomes an ellipse, with degrees of foreshortening determined by the onlooker's eye level. Still, faced with an ellipse, beginners still draw a circle. When drawing from observation, we need to unlearn the ready-made shorthand generalizations we use when dealing with the three-dimensional world, and be prepared to be surprised by the unfamiliar sight of shapes as we see them from a single static viewpoint, less fettered by symbolic simplification. Here are two student drawing samples. Notice how more the top lip appears visible in the drawing than in the photo, perhaps owing to the top lip being masked by shadow in the photo. But here's something else to consider. The shape of the mouth is also different in the drawing. When we confront a face in life or we're asked to draw a face, our left brain is used to more complete or symbolic and symmetrical representations of lips and mouths. Thus, it feels it needs to see parts of the mouth or lips which, when viewed from a certain vantage point, aren't even visible. Drawing from life involves ways of getting around assumptions on how we see and interpret visual form. A portraiture is particularly challenging because of all the attendant associations of fellow persons, the referential meaning of eyes, facial expressions, which have held great significance to us since infancy. Portraiture can be different from drawing, say, more impersonal or inanimate objects like a cup or a bowl or a table. The symbolic has a way of sneaking in and distorting our view of things. Like the circle, we have the idea of the essence of I, a perfect, symmetrically formed I in our minds. But this conflicts with the aspect of things we see before us. The eye, as we know it in the physical world, is a sphere embedded into an orbit, a hole in the skull, with flaps of skin, eyelids, draped over it. One wonders if a bit of symbolization of quote-unquote eye crept in a bit, even in this drawing.